My name is Brendan from Biomerio, and I'm the Global Solutions Manager for the Endotoxin business.
And my name is Zoya. I am the Marketing Manager in Central Europe, and welcome to the first episode of What's Next? The World of Endotoxin.
Hi, Zoya. What's Next is a mini-series of super short podcasts on everything endotoxin. Today on episode one, we're going to start at the beginning and investigate what is endotoxin and how it came to be, from danger to discovery.
For today's episode, we have the world-renowned endotoxin expert, Kevin Williams. Thank you for being with us today, Kevin. Welcome.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks for coming, Kevin. So, Kevin, what is endotoxin?
Endotoxins are also called lipopolysaccharides, which means the molecules have both a sugar and a lipid moiety. They exist only in the outer membrane of gram-negative bacteria. It actually takes 9 different cellular enzymes to put together an LPS molecule.
And where do these endotoxin or lipopolysaccharides come from?
Endotoxins are present wherever gram-negative bacteria can grow, which is virtually anywhere. They're prevalent in seawater and freshwater and can grow up very quickly, even in very clean water. They build up as the little dead exoskeletons of bacteria or as sloughed off during growth in the form of what are called membrane vesicles.
So can these endotoxins grow by themselves?
Endotoxin is not alive, so it can't grow except as a part of the living gram-negative bacterial cells as they multiply. But in these cells, they can grow up very rapidly, especially in water environments.
And how was endotoxin discovered and by whom?
The discovery of endotoxin is mostly credited to Richard Pfeiffer just prior to the 1900s. He discovered that the toxic activity, which was well known by then, couldn't be separated from the cellular material. Thus, he named it endotoxin in contrast to the exotoxins that were well known. In the mid-1920s, when they started to manufacture injectable drugs, there was a phenomenon known as injection fever. Francis Siebert figured out that this was due to endotoxin contamination, and the rabbit pyrogen test was developed around this time to preclude these fever events.
So why the focus on endotoxin in pharma manufacturing?
An easy way to remember the properties of endotoxin is the acronym LPS. Where L is the likelihood of occurrence, P is the potency relative to other contaminants, and S is the very stable nature of endotoxin, which includes high resistance to heat. Today, the rapid detection of endotoxin helps to prevent problems in manufacturing at every point, excipient use, API production, processing, drug filling.
So a sterile product will not have endotoxin in it?
Well, a solution can be free of living cells, so it can be sterile but still contain endotoxin. So endotoxin is tested throughout the manufacturing process alongside bioburden, and in finished products, it's tested alongside sterility testing.
And finally, is there anything new with endotoxin?
As a paradigm change, the biologics revolution that has produced so many life-saving drugs and treatments has seen the replacement of naturally harvested proteins with recombinant proteins. Examples of this would be animal insulin to human insulin and the use of recombinant growth hormone instead of that harvested sometimes from cadavers. The same technology has allowed for the production of RFC without harvesting horseshoe crab blood.
Wow, really interesting. Thanks a lot, Kevin. So, Oya, endotoxin is in almost everything.
Well, hopefully not in injectables.
Well, thank you, everyone, for viewing. Thank you, Kevin, for your expertise. Make sure you all look out for our next episode coming in 2 weeks.
It will be about endotoxin and the body. If you would like to watch any other episodes, please click on the link provided and they will be updated as they are made.
So, as we say goodbye, remember, wear a mask, wash your hands, and stay safe.